I'm delighted to welcome Grace Weir as our first keynote presenter for her presentation lecture. Grace has recently had a large exhibition at IMMA in Dublin. It finished in March, which was called Three Different Nights Recurring. And in that exhibition, she had three new films, a number of other films. One of those films we're going to see shortly. There were very many extraordinary pieces in this exhibition. And one of the ones that struck me most forcibly and kept repeating in my mind was a series of paintings that were made on photographic paper with photographic ink that was not light resistant, not light fixed. So those paintings will change at different rates. The temporal stretch of their life is something that constantly is changing, and as we think about it, it's being inhabited in our thinking process. I'd like to welcome Grace for her presentation, and thank you very much.
By actually taking a photograph of everybody here, like a kind of a record of us here at this conference about archives. So I'm using a Polaroid camera, the very first instant cameras that were made. So if you just bear with me. Light is actually very poor, so let's hope it's not too, it's much darker now than on, so, or darker than it was earlier, so it took a bit longer. So Nick is going to take a photograph of me just to kind of complete this little archive. I wanted to make a kind of record of the light of us here at the beginning of my talk, before the talk actually takes place. So you can actually put that back on if you want. Photographs are a form of documentation of an event. They act as an interpretation of an event when it is no longer being experienced. They form a record that can be looked at to help us more accurately remember this time at a later time. I'm interested in how a document can be addressed, but not just as a fixed repository of the past, but also in the way it can act as a means of forming other presence, generating other temporalities, and in aspects of events, effects or feelings that are perhaps overlooked during an event or considered transitory at the time, and in how to address the separation that exists between events as we experience them and the records made. You can actually close those lines next to me, I think. I recently participated in a residency as an artist at the School of Physics in Trinity College in Dublin. It was officially for 3 months, which then actually was extended to 6 months, and it ended up being about 3 years. It was through working in film and photography that I returned to an interest in physics that I had in school before the great divide happens into art and science. It was the more I worked in video and photography, the more interested I became in the specific qualities and nature of the media themselves. Time and light are both intrinsic to filmmaking and photography. Making a photograph can be understood both as making an index of light, which may or may not be formed by a lens into something recognisable, and as a means of putting oneself into a certain relation to the world that feels like the marking of a record, the making of a record, the marking of a certain moment in time. Time became increasingly of interest to me the more I worked in film. The Russian film director Tarkovsky called making films sculpting in time. Film addresses the time in which something is being actualised, the time it takes for something to happen. It maps one time, the time of the recorded event, onto another time, the present time of its viewing. And these kinds of inhabitation of the present interest me, and the shaping of this. So it was working in these media that led me to approach a physicist in order to understand time better. I approached an astrophysicist, Ian Elliott, and asked him if we could talk about Einstein's relativity. We had a two-hour cup of coffee followed by an 18-month period of meeting up and talking about ideas of physics. And most physicists laugh when I say I wanted to understand relativity over a cup of coffee. But we connected through the use of diagrams and the desire to express complex ideas with a conceptual economy. But at one point late in our interactions, I understood relativity and its implications. And it was a profound and sublime moment, which I never really recovered from. I always thought I had a kind of panic attack after that, kind of as to what I was doing, because I was an artist, and it was quite an extraordinary concept to come to grips with. Newton thought of time as existing independently, flowing equally without relation to anything external. Einstein's equations made time and space dynamic by showing how they were distorted by the matter and energy present, and that this distortion determines how matter moves through space, that the only constant that exists is the speed of light. Everything else is mutable. Relativity is hard to hold onto, as it is counterintuitive. James Lunny, the head of the School of Physics, told me that he learns it anew each year when he teaches it to the first years. But I remain with an interest in the dynamical relationship between time and space, and how everything depends on the way you understand the passage of time, that an understanding of time is intrinsic to an understanding of history. I have a friend who's a philosopher of time, Sean Endepower, and he talks about the different theories of times that exist. He writes, the idea that the past, the future is unreal and only the present is real, that this one time is real, is presentism. But there is an alternative, that multiple times and even multiple presents are real. This is eternalism. He also makes a further distinction to this. Some philosophers, tense theorists, argue that although the past or future may be real, they are not real in the same vivid or significant way that the present is real. The nowness or thenness of an event is something central to reality. For tense theorists, there is one present, the past, one future. The opposing claim by tenseless theorists holds that events are not really tensed. Whether or not a certain event is called past, present, or future is not something about the event. It is something about your relation to the event. Now and then is making a distinction in the same way as here and there is, or near and far away. There are multiple presents, pasts, or futures. As we understand, there are multiple places. It just depends on when you're standing, as opposed to where. But since antiquity, the facility of light to reproduce an image of the world has been observed. In a darkened room, light, when it enters through a small hole, creates an inverted image of what is outside the room. It was the desire to fix this image, to make a permanent record, that led to the invention of photography. The camera obscura, the Latin for darkroom, is known to have been used as a tool approximately for 400 years before the first photograph was ever created. It was used primarily to aid artists in drawing, so they could achieve a more accurate representation of their subject matter. Using the camera obscura, a French artist and scientist, Niepce, is said to have created the first photograph. Niepce created the image by placing a metal plate coated with chemicals inside the camera obscura. After 8 hours of being exposed to the sun, an image appeared. He called the process heliography, from Helios for the sun. His colleague, Louis Daguerre, was familiar with the camera obscura because he also used it as a painting tool. But he was able in 1837 to reduce the exposure time to 30 minutes. But it was an astronomer, John Herschel, who was credited with coining the word photography in 1839, which is based on the Greek phos, meaning light, and graph, meaning drawing, writing, together meaning drawing with light. Herschel was also the first to use the terms negative and positive within photography. Herschel introduced the chemical gallic acid to photography, and this photosensitive chemical is what led to William Henry Fox Tollett's calotype, a photographic image on paper. The term calotype comes from the Greek kalos for beautiful and typos for impression. The main difference between this process and Daguerre's, other than the use of paper over metal, is that the calotype is a negative image, so many positives could be produced from one negative. It was during 1839 that this photographic process first became public, and this is generally considered the birth year of practical photography. But while I was on residency in the School of Physics, I travelled with a group of astronomers to Birr Castle in the centre of Ireland. I went to see the Leviathan, which was the world's biggest telescope for over 70 years, from 1845 to 1917. It was built by William Parsons and his wife Mary Ross. She did all the ironwork for it. And they both spent many years polishing mirrors in preparation for it. And this kind of gives you an idea of it. It's in the middle of Ireland, so it's very good for dark skies away from the coasts and where cities are built. But while I was there, I saw a large collection of astronomical drawings by William Parsons, predating astronomical photography, looking through his telescope. He drew what he saw, making a record of the night sky. He was the first person who discovered that galaxies are spiral-shaped, making a series of drawings of a whirlpool galaxy, repeating the image over several nights as a form of proof of his discovery. Incidentally, it's been suggested that his drawings of the Whirlpool Galaxy may have influenced Vincent van Gogh's Starry Night, as the drawings were reproduced by Camille Flammarion, a French writer who popularized Parsons' drawings at the time. It was a note, actually, on one of these drawings that led to the title of my recent exhibition at the Irish Museum of Modern Art, Three Different Nights Recurring. The note reads, you can see it here in the corner, "Sketch on the paper was wet with dew, but carefully compared to the original on three different nights." What interested me was the alignment of a living experience of the world with knowledge of it, sketching his discovery on a sheet of paper wet with dew, and how the imperfect world of direct experience plays a role in our understanding of the more factual concepts. It points to the idea of facts not as self-evident objects in the world, but as processes towards the complicated mediations by which facts acquire their immediacy. I was also interested in the need for repetition, in his going out each night and drawing it repeatedly before he could state it as a truth. What else happened on those nights, and how were they different? And I was drawn to both the open-endedness and recurrences of his everyday practice, and the levels where identity or recognizability and time coincide. The note also speaks of the paradoxically unique but repeatable nature of time. Part of what particularly interested me in these records is that when we gaze at the stars, we're looking at the past. That by the time starlight reaches us across the vast distances in space, what the light shows is actually the past light from the star, not the current light being emitted. The drawings are a record of a past light seen from a past time, but a different one. George Kubler, who Joe mentioned earlier on, an American art historian, in his book The Shape of Time, Remarks on the History of Things, presents an approach to historical change which challenged the notion of style by placing the history of objects and images in a larger continuum. Kubler proposes new forms of historical sequencing where objects and images provide solutions to evolving problems. The book presents, amongst other things, a critical view of separation of the history of art and the history of science. Writing on the relationship between astronomers and historians, he writes, "The galaxy whose light I see now may have ceased to exist millennia ago. And by the same token, men cannot fully sense any event until after it has happened, until it is history, until it is the dust and ashes of that cosmic storm which we call the present, and which perpetually rages throughout creation. Knowing the past is as astonishing a performance as knowing the stars. Astronomers look only at old light. There is no other light for them to look at. This old light of dead or distant stars was emitted long ago, and it reaches us only in the present. Astronomers and historians have this in common. Both are concerned with appearances noted in the present but occurring in the past. The historian and the astronomer both transpose, reduce, compose, and colour a facsimile which describes the shape of time. Many historical events, like astronomical bodies, also occur long before they appear, such as secret treaties or important works of art made for ruling personages. The physical substance of these documents often reaches qualified observers only centuries after the event. Both astronomers and historians collect ancient signals into compelling theories about distance and composition. The astronomer's position is the historian's date. His velocity is our sequence. The astronomer and the historian both deal with past events perceived in the present. Here the parallels diverge. For the astronomer, future events are physical and recurrent ones, while for the historian, they're human and unpredictable. The foregoing analogies are nevertheless useful in prompting us to look again at the nature of historical evidence so that we may be sure of our ground when considering various ways of classing it. But I became interested in the idea of making an image of a star, a record of its light, but without a camera, the opposite of a snapshot, in making a long shot of the light from a star, to make an archive of the light from the past, an unmediated image made only by a star's light, where a sheet of film would become a boundary between the present and what is past. And Through being in the School of Physics, I talked to an astronomer, Graham Harper, about Betelgeuse, the ninth brightest star in the night sky. Betelgeuse is in the constellation of Orion. It is a red supergiant that is in a late stage of stellar evolution. As it takes the light from this star 640 years to reach us, there exists the possibility that the star has already died and is no longer visible, but we don't know it yet. The loss of its light may not have reached us yet. I basically constructed a device, a meter-long piece of plastic tube with a wooden box at the end, and I placed a sheet of photographic film inside. I had terrible trouble trying to find film that was sensitive to red light because it's a red star, because of course all film is not sensitive to red light, so you can use it in a dark room and turn on a red light and not be affected. But eventually I found an out-of-date, no longer produced film that was. And I attached this whole device that I made onto another device that maintained the same rotation as the Earth. I then pointed the tube, my tube, at the star, and because it rotated the same speed as the Earth, I was able to keep it fixed in the star for long exposure times. I tried to do this in Ireland over one whole winter, and it never worked out because it kept clouding over or raining. And then I went to Tenerife, following the path of many astronomers to the beautiful transparent skies of the Canary Islands. And nobody believed me when I said I was going there for work. But I went there and I was able to kind of make these photograms over the course of a night. Over five nights I made these. So the images, each photograph is made tracking the star over the course of the night, and they're dated according to the length of time it took the photons to leave the star, travel across space, fall down my tube, and extinguish on the film. So they're called The History of Light, circa 1374 to the 20th of December 2014. That was a 6 hour, 9 minute exposure. I was also interested in the kind of temporal gap between these as kind of negatives and the positive, and wanted to show these exposed films with prints made from them as a kind of binary of differing temporalities of the same phenomenon. And these were dated according to the print. And I showed these in, there's five, 10 altogether, five pairs of five nights, two versions. But while I was in Birr with these astronomers, I was unexpectedly invited to see Mary Ross's, who helped him build the telescope. I was invited to see her darkroom within the castle. Mary Ross built her darkroom prompted by a desire to photograph the moon. She was a pioneer of photography in Ireland in the 1850s. To put that in context, you have to remember that this is just 11 years or so after a practical process for photography was invented. So her interest in photography began at a time when photography was more akin to chemistry, and the highly stable emulsions which are common today had not been invented. She was in dialogue with Fox Talbot, adjusting her salts for the damp conditions in Ireland. Incidentally, William Parsons and Mary were the people who helped persuade Fox Talbot to release his photographic methodologies to the public, because he was very secretive about how he did it, but they helped persuade him to release it for the good, public good. But she was the first woman to win the Silver Medal Award for the Royal, at the Royal Photographic Society for her work in the 1850s. And you can see her here seated in this photograph. She's actually holding a stereogram, a double stereo transparency, which can be viewed through the stereoscopic viewer that the other lady is holding. She became very interested in stereoscopic photography, largely because of the pioneering work of her friend David Brewster, who invented a very practical stereoscope. And these kind of images were very popular in the 1850s. Stereoscopy is the production of the illusion of depth in a photograph by the presentation of a slightly different image to each eye. The effect was created by taking two photographs with the optical centre of the lenses separated by the same distance as those of the eye. These two images then combined in the brain to give the perception of depth. And these are off the telescope, so you can see the slightly different angles taken. In this one, you can see, if you notice, the dog has actually moved off between the exposure on the left and the one on the right, because there would have taken about 6 to 8 images for seconds for each image to take, so the children's faces are also a little blurry. I mean, this is pre-cinema, but actually I really feel you can actually see, you get the desire for cinema through the sense of kind of duration and motion that these kind of images had. But her darkroom was actually closed off in the early 1900s, and it kind of disappeared from the family's consciousness. It laid untouched for over 80 years until 1983, when it was kind of rediscovered and opened up again. And I went to see it Brendan Parsons, actually, who's the grandson of, great-grandson of William Parsons, he actually opened this kind of big creaking door down the basement, and about 1,000 insects flew out, and I had to overcome my phobia about insects and my desire to see the darkroom. And I got in there, and I didn't have a camera, but I borrowed a camera from one of the astronomers and took this quick snap while I was there. And I left that day, but a few weeks later, I contacted the family, and Alison Ross, in particular, Brendan's wife, to ask if I could come back and photograph it properly. And on the phone with her, I heard that the darkroom was actually in the process of being dismantled prior to being relocated and rebuilt in an exact reconstruction in the more accessible exhibition centre in the castle's grounds. I mean, other than wanting to say, please don't do it, I think partly prompted by a sense of loss, I asked if I could return to the room where the darkroom originally was. And while I was there, I filmed a sequence of video shots within the emptied room. And I felt that I'd missed this thing that I had briefly seen, that it was gone the next time I came, but I filmed in this emptied space. But back in my studio, looking at the photograph and this footage, I began thinking about the relationship between reconstruction and photography, both attempt to fix a moment. I contacted Alison again and asked if I could return and film in the reconstruction of the darkroom, where the entire contents had been moved and reconstructed exactly by conservators. This time I reconstructed my earlier shoot, exposing the camera as a device, its framing and focus pulling, filming the activity of photographing these reconstructed shots within the reconstruction. I had become interested in the nature of memory and its mediation through photography. I had a moment, actually, when I placed the snapshot I took of the original darkroom in her developing dish, Mary Ross's developing dish, in the reconstruction. I mean, what was real at that point, my photograph of the original darkroom in her actual dish in the reconstruction. But I connected with her. I felt a sense of connection with her through the making of my own photographic record, recording the activity in this darkroom, rooting into practice as the connection between us, an archive of thought and doing. And I'm going to show you this film now. And these two different temporal streams, one filmed in the original darkroom and one filmed in the reconstruction, are shown side by side. In a gallery, they're normally shown bigger at a slight angle, but we have to go with what the here. So, I'm not sure if I have to. This is 7.5 minutes long. The thing I find about archives is when you get into them is how do you get out of them again? So it was actually while I was editing the work that I was actually on a residency in a place called Cowhouse in Ireland, and I was actually sitting on top of a darkroom. I was up in a mezzanine studio and I was above a darkroom, and I asked the guy who ran the residency if he would show me the darkroom process again, because I hadn't done it since I was in college many moons ago. And it was while I was doing it, I decided to remake the photograph of the darkroom, kind of to make another repetition. It kind of interested me, the making through an analog means of a digital image, another repetition. You can pop that up there. So basically, earlier we made a decision, we kind of attempted to correlate the event here with images of the event. And currently we're still in the middle of this. We're still talking, we're still here together, still in a netherworld of light and chemicals and paper that are still in process, still forming in this present, still making a document of an event that is still developing in time. In the unfolding of any event, there's a time of actualization of occurrence. What interests me here actually is also the parallel with cinema, like this becomes almost filmic, the slow developing of this type of Polaroid film. The viewer becomes the developer of time, to quote Deleuze. What interests me is the idea that the experience of time in film consists of a succession of instantaneous present moments. What we see as present occurs over an interval. But we're making a still image here. How long will it take? In 1895, Louis Lumière presented to the public a program of his short films, his actualities. And their duration was determined by the material length of the roll of the film, about 40 seconds for each of them. The sense of time differs from other senses, since time cannot be perceived directly, but must be reconstructed by the brain. There's a very short time in which change and duration are alleged to be directly experienced. It is called the specious present, the time duration wherein one's perceptions are considered to be in the present. The concept was developed by William James, one of the founders of modern psychology. James defined the specious present in 1890 to be the prototype of all conceived times, the short duration of which we are immediate and incessantly sensible. We are constantly aware of a certain duration, the specious present, varying from a few seconds to probably not more than a minute, and this duration, with its content perceived as having one part earlier and one part later, is the original intuition of time. But we have no means of gauging the temporal span or length of the present independent of content. That needs to be the duration of something, the time it takes for a note to be heard, for example. While any duration event is going on, its duration cannot be assessed. Time is subjective in the mind, and our perception of temporal duration is bound up with memory. Einstein described time as being like a river. He said, occasionally it's broad and slow or narrow and fast, with rivulets that can break off and return at different points. Between 1905 and 1915, he developed his theory of relativity, which is based on the nature of light and showed how time as being something fixed, a regular rhythmic entity, was wrong. Henri Bergson, a major French philosopher who was influential in the same period, believed that the processes of mediate experience and intuition are more significant than abstract rationalism or science for understanding reality. He thought relativity involved a conception of time which it in itself did not bring out, but which was up to philosophy to construct. In Bergson's philosophy, the intellect is connected to spatialized time and intuition is connected to life and duration. The intellect by nature is a spatializing mechanism. To acquire knowledge, it employs concepts, symbols, abstraction, analysis, fragmentation. The intellect gives us a fragmented but necessary pragmatic view, grasp of reality, whereas intuition is the means by which to grasp the essential element of reality, which is duration. Bergson approached the subject of the nature of time by distinguishing two ways of knowing, relative and absolute. The relative kind is achieved by moving around an object or by coming to know it through symbols or words that fails to render its true nature. Absolute knowledge is achieved by experiencing something as it is from within. This absolute knowledge can only be given by intuition, which he defined as the kind of intellectual sympathy by which one places oneself within an object in order to coincide with what is unique in it and consequently inexpressible. He writes, wherever anything lives, there is open somewhere a register in which time is being inscribed. But it was during both of their lifetimes that the desire for a unified world time began. In 1884, representatives from 25 countries convened at a conference in Washington and proposed to establish Greenwich as a zero meridian for the purposes of timekeeping. They determined the exact length of the day and divided the Earth into 24 time zones, 1 hour apart. Before that, you had to adjust your watch continuously as you travelled from local place to local place. Each city had its own time, which was taken from solar readings. This was actually more accurate. But the world was very slow to adopt the system for all its obvious practicality. Despite all the scientific and military arguments for world time, it was actually the railway companies and not the governments that were the first to begin to institute it. France in 1912 finally took the lead in the movement for unified world time. Broadcasts began from the Eiffel Tower in May of 1910, and at 10 o'clock on July the 1st in 1913, the Eiffel Tower sent out the first time signal that was transmitted around the world, and the world set its clocks to an agreed time. The introduction of world standard time created a greater uniformity of shared public time. It brought ideas about a sense of connectivity, the same time everywhere, all people at once. Concepts of the great distance of space were reduced, along with the primacy of a linear sense of time, with past, present, and future each succeeding the other in turn. Thinking about succession gave way to concepts of simultaneity. So it was during the same period, basically, when the first global time signal was sent out into the world, that Einstein showed how Newton's time, a time that flowed without relation to anything external, was wrong, that time is one aspect of a four-dimensional continuum. Cubism, developing also during the same period, objects are analysed, broken up, and reassembled in abstracted form. Instead of depicting objects from one viewpoint, artists depict the subject from a multitude of viewpoints to represent the subject in a greater context. In the field of mathematics, Poincaré develops the field of topology, a term coined in 1914. Topology is the study of geometric properties and spatial relations that are unaffected by continuous change of shape. It is the study of the property of things that remain the same despite repeated deformations. A mathematician actually apparently introduced the cubist to these new mathematical developments of the time, giving Picasso a copy of a book which popularized Poincaré's work. Michel Serre, a contemporary French writer who studied mathematics and philosophy, talks about the void that exists between the hard sciences and the human sciences. He thinks that everything depends on the way you understand the passage of time, that an understanding of time is inherent to an understanding of history, or the supposition that the past is out of date. Time percolates and flows in a turbulent and chaotic manner. It is a topologically bizarre space. We speak of time in an inadequate and oversimplistic way. According to Serre, time can be schematized by a crumpling, a multiple foldable diversity. Out of this foldability emerges then a related phenomenon. Topological time materializes itself in a spatially foldable nearness. Serre demonstrates his point through the example of a sketch on a handkerchief. If you take a handkerchief and spread it out in order to iron it, you can see in it certain fixed distances and proximities. If you sketch a circle in one area of the handkerchief, you can mark out nearby points and measure far off distances. Then take the same handkerchief and crumple it, putting it in your pocket. Two distant points suddenly are close, even superimposed. If further, you tear it in certain places, two points that were close can become very distant. This science of nearness and rifts is topology, while the science of stable and well-defined distances is geometry. It is the difference between the topology, where the handkerchief is folded, crumpled, or shredded, and geometry, where the same fabric is ironed flat. As we experience time as much in our inner sense as externally in nature, it resembles this crumpled version much more than the flat, overly simplified one. For Serre, time isn't linear, it doesn't march or unroll progress. We can't mark out events or achievements with points on a number line, regulating or forgetting everything on the left to the past and leaving everything on the right to be filled in. He writes, "What things are contemporary? Consider the latest car. It is an aggregate of technical solutions dating from different periods. One part invented 10 years ago, one at the turn of the century, or the wheel dating back to Neolithic times. It is only contemporary by its design or finish, sometimes only by its advertising." Serre positions time as a non-linear disorder in which the experience of presentness may contain past events, regardless of how temporally distant they are from one another. The French word for time is le temps, and it's the same word for weather. I really liked Alison's description earlier on. I can't remember the phrase now, but the movement and how the weather and how of movement, that expression. But Serre says that time can be thought as a kind of weather system, expanding, contracting, intensifying at different intervals. His time is not a horizon, but rather more like a cloud or a storm front. Each point of present, each swelling front, accumulates from other domains of temporality. For Sarah, in this sense, the past is and has never been out of date. And now we're kind of reaching the end, and this is slowly developing. This time for talking is over, and the images of it, the record, are starting to form. These drawings of light of something that is past, almost past now, that is almost over, are finally becoming present. But soon the nearness between us, the event, and its record will finish and unfold, and an increasing distance grow. Thanks.